Cek cek ya, baiklah kita membahas pertemuan kali ini terakhir ya. Ini untuk chapter 3. Setelah ini kita lanjut ke chapter 4. Okay. Good.
Dan lanjutkan di chapter 3, Gates Anomaly, masuk di subbab yang terakhir. Setelah kita kemarin membahas discrete symmetry dan hubungannya dengan ad hoc anomali, sepertinya sekarang kita akan membahas generalized symmetries. We want to build up to understanding discrete anomalies in anomalies theory. However, the anomalies turn out to lie in a class of symmetries that are little unfamiliar. Then, this goes by the name of generalized symmetry. Kita ingin membangun pemahaman tentang discrete anomali di Young-Mills theory, tetapi anomali tersebut berada di dalam kelas simetri yang lumayan tidak familiar. Mereka disebut dengan generalized symmetry. We'll first discuss generalized global symmetry as opposed to gauge symmetries. We are very used to dealing with such symmetry as acting on field, or more generally, local operator of the operator. Pertama-tama kita akan membahas generalized global symmetry as opposed to gauge symmetry. Kita akan membahas generalized global symmetry. Kita sangat terbiasa dengan symmetry tersebut yang beraksi pada medan atau secara umum lokal operator dari teori tersebut. We have put continuous and discrete symmetry. Ini untuk global symmetry ya. Continuous symmetry have an associate current J, which is a one form obeying this R J equal zero. Symmetry yang kontinu itu dia akan mempunyai current J, yang current J-nya itu adalah sebuah one form yang memenuhi persamaan kontinuitas current seperti biasa di star J equal zero. Turunan eksterior biasa ya, dan starnya hot star. Sepertinya kita sudah membahas ini sebelumnya. Maksudnya tentang turunan eksterior dan hot star. Yeah. In contrast to the rest of the lectures, throughout this section we use the notation of form. Oh, belum sepertinya. Tapi kita sudah pernah membahas ini di string. The charge is constructed from J together with a codimension. Codimension one submanifold M subset X. Ini berarti kalau misalkan manifoldnya dimensi 4, berarti kodimensi satunya itu submanifold berdimensi 3 ya. Jadi misalkan spacetime kita 4 dimensi. M di sini nanti volume dari spacetime tadi. Volume 3 dimensi dari spacetime tadi. Karena Q, Q kan charge, dan muatan itu memang diintegralkan terhadap volume 3 dimensi. This charge then acts on local operator defined at a point X by then. Muatan tadi beraksi kepada lokal operator PHY yang aksi dari charge itu adalah seperti persamaan yang dikotakin biru. EIQ phi ix sama dengan rij phi jx. Dengan rij itu adalah generator dari grup elemen dan x anggota M. Jadi EIQ kalau kena vij itu sama dengan rij phi jx. Ini berarti sepertinya ada Einstein summation-nya. DJ. If we have discrete symmetry, there is no current, but nonetheless the generator is still associated to a co-dimension one manifold. Ya, kalau kita tadi kalau simetrinya continue ya, dia akan punya current. Tapi kalau kita simetrinya discrete, tidak ada current, tetapi generatornya itu nanti tetap akan ada hubungannya dengan co-dimension one manifold. We will refer to both continuous and discrete symmetry of this type as a zero form symmetry. Jadi yang barusan kita bahas itu kita sebut dengan type zero one zero form symmetries. Jadi kalau zero form symmetries nanti current-nya itu adalah one form yang dia Q-nya atau muatannya itu adalah integral dari one form tersebut di submanifold M kodimensi satu dari spacetime. These are the usual familiar symmetries of quantum field theory that we happily work with our whole life. Jadi yang barusan kita jelaskan itu yang biasa. Nah, kita mau mengeneralisasi ide tersebut. The idea of a generalized symmetry is to extend the ideas above to higher form symmetry. We define a Q form symmetry to be one such that generator is associated to a codimension Q plus 1 manifold M subset Q. Jadi kalau tadi 0 berarti Q-nya 0 ya. Kalau Q-nya 0 berarti dia nanti generatornya terasosiasi dengan kodimensi satu manifold. Tetapi kalau kita generalisasi menjadi Q ya nanti dia akan terasosiasi dengan kodimensi Q plus 1 submanifold dari spacetime kita. If this matrix continues, then there is a Q plus 1 form current J, and the generator can again be written as 3.82. Ini ya. For Q greater than 0, this generalized symmetry are always abelian. Untuk simetri yang dia Q-nya lebih dari 0 atau Q form symmetry yang Q-nya lebih dari 0, maka generalized symmetry-nya itu selalu abelian. This follow from the group multiplication QJ1 M QJ2 M. When Q equals 0, the manifold M are codimension 1. And we can make sense of this product by time ordering the manifold M. Karena nanti nggak harus abelian ya. Kalau apa namanya? Kalau Q-nya 0. Sehingga nanti produknya itu harus di time ordering dulu. For Q greater than 0, there is no such ordering. This means that the operator must all commute with each other. Karena abelian. Abelian itu komutnya. A Q-form symmetry X on an operator associated to Q-dimensional manifold C. A Q-form symmetry X on operator associated to Q-dimensional manifold C. Here our interest lie in one-form symmetries that act on line operator such as the Wilson and Atoff lines. Take, for example, a Wilson line W. The action of a one-form symmetry takes the form QW equal R W, where R is a phase and the manifold M and C have linking number one. Itu adalah yang okay, kita akan bahas contohnya. Contohnya adalah generalized symmetry in Maxwell theory. Our ultimate interest is in generalized symmetry in Young-Bell's theory, but it will prove useful to first discuss generalized symmetry in the context of pure Maxwell theory. Kita akan bahas generalized symmetry di pure Maxwell theory. Jadi nggak ada meter field-nya. Pure kita membahas gauge field-nya saja. There are two form which are conserved. Each can be took of current of each can be took of as the current for a global one-form symmetry. Yaitu electric one-form symmetry G, JA equal, berarti ini two form ya. Two form current. Dan ini two form current. Each of this current is conserved in the sense that the theory obey d star j equals zero. Ya, dia conserved dan memenuhi persamaan d star j equals zero. The electric one-form symmetry shift the gauge field by a flat connection a transform to a plus d alpha. Dan electric one-form symmetry-nya itu merubah gauge field connection-nya menjadi A plus D alpha. Fungsinya dia akan invarian ya. In contrast, the action of the magnetic one-form symmetry is difficult to see in the electric description. Instead, it shifts the magnetic gauge field A tilt by a flat connection. Relatedly, the electric one-form symmetry acts on Wilson line W and the magnetic one-form symmetry acts on at half lines T. Yang electric one form symmetry-nya X on Wilson line. Sedangkan yang magnetic one form-nya X on at half line. Kita sudah membahas at Wilson line dan at half line di chapter sebelumnya sepertinya. The fate of the symmetries depend on the phase of the theory, which, as explained in section 2.5 and 2.6, is governed by Wilson and Atoffline expected expectation values. This typically give either area law or parameter law. We will say area law, expectation value dari Wilson lines-nya itu proporsional dengan eksponensial minus A, A-nya ini area. Jika expectation value dari Wilson lines-nya itu proportional dengan E to the minus A, maka Wilson line expectation value dari Wilson lines-nya sama dengan 0. Tapi jika expectation value dari Wilson Lies-nya itu proporsional dengan E to the minus L, di mana L-nya ini adalah perimeter, maka Wilson expectation value-nya itu tidak nol. This may look a little arbitrary, but it is a natural generalization of what we already know. A traditional zero form symmetry is said to be spontaneously broken if its charged operator O has expectation value O of E. Simetri yang kita biasa pahami yaitu zero form symmetry itu disebut spontaneously broken jika sebuah operator bermuatan O itu mempunyai expectation value limit x minus y to infinite. Ini expectation value-nya itu tidak sama dengan 0. In other words, the expectation value depend only on the edge point x and y. The analogy for a one-form symmetry is that the expectation value depend only on the perimeter. Oh ya, jadi kalau zero form symmetry maka expectation value-nya itu hanya bergantung dengan titik-titik di ujung x and y. Nah, analoginya kalau one form symmetry maka dia expectation value-nya depend hanya di perimeter. Contoh konkretnya ya, misalkan ada line gitu ya, maka boundary-nya kan ya ini x dan y gitu. Tapi kalau kita dimensinya tambah satu, nanti berarti ya keseluruhan line ini yang akan jadi itunya apa namanya, depend only on the parameter seperti itu. Kalau yang zero form tadi depend only on the edge point. With this convention, in the Coulomb phase, we have expectation value of the Wilson line tidak sama dengan nol dan expectation value of ad hoc line tidak sama dengan nol. So that both symmetry are spontaneously broken. But a broken global symmetry should give rise to associated massless Goldstone boson. Ya, ini Goldstone theorem ya. Kalau ada global symmetry yang broken, maka akan muncul massless Goldstone boson. This is nothing but the photon itself. Oh, dan massless Goldstone bosonnya itu adalah foton. F mu nu. Expectation value dari vakum F mu nu epsilon koma P, epsilon polarization P-nya momentum, dia sebanding dengan ini AIPX. This gives a rather surprising new perspective on an old question. Whenever we have massless degree of freedom, there is usually some underlying reason, but for massless scalar fields, Goldstone theorem typically provides the reason. But we see that we can also invoke Goldstone theorem to explain why the photon is gapless. We just need to extend its validity to higher form symmetry. Jadi biasanya sih Goldstone boson digunakan untuk menjelaskan scalar fields ya. Tetapi kalau kita extend the symmetry to higher order, maka untuk vektor ini kan bisa dibilang dia vektor gitu. Gaussian teoremnya itu bisa dipakai untuk menjelaskan kenapa foton itu gapless. We can also think about the fate of this matrix when we add matter to the theory. Suppose first that we introduce charged electric degrees of freedom. This explicitly breaks the electric one-form symmetry since this star J proportional to d star f. Misalkan kita mengenalkan charge electric degree of freedom. This explicitly breaks the electric one-form symmetry since d star J proportional to d star f, karena J-nya nanti proportional to f ya. Ini kalau yang elektrik. Which no longer vanishes because the Maxwell equation now have a source. Ya, karena sekarang udah ada meter, maka kuantitas ini itu tidak vanish karena ada source. However, the magnetic symmetry which follow from the Bianchi identity survives. Bianchi identity itu ini ya. Dan dia memang selalu seperti ini. It is spontaneously broken in the Coulomb phase but unbroken in the Higgs phase. Moreover, here, we have magnetic vortex string described in section 2.5.2 that carry charge under one form symmetry. Jadi, magnetic vortex string yang sudah kita bahas itu membawa muatan, dan muatannya itu adalah muatan dari one form symmetry kita. Jadi kalau kita extend konsep simetri kita ke higher order, maka hal-hal yang sudah kita jelaskan di atas itu bisa kita pahami dengan lebih konvensional. Maksudnya seperti Gaussian theorem di atas. In contrast, if we introduce magnetic degrees of freedom, then only the electric one form symmetry survive. Kemudian kalau kita add electric degrees of freedom, electric one form symmetry-nya itu no longer apa namanya? Ini persamaan yang di star J-nya itu no longer vanishes, tetapi untuk yang magnetic symmetry-nya itu tetap survives. Sedangkan kalau kita introduce magnetic degree of freedom, maka electric one form-nya itu survive, sedangkan yang electric one form-nya survive. Harusnya magnetic one form-nya tetap survive karena Bianchi identity juga. This is broken in the Coulomb phase but unbroken in the Higgs phase where the confining electric string carry charge. There is a variant of this. Suppose that we add electrically charged matter but with charge N. Then there is a Zn electric one form symmetry which shifts the gauge field by a flat connection with Zn holonomy which leaves the matter invariant. In the Coulomb phase, both the symmetry and the magnetic one-form symmetry are broken. Jika kita menambah electric charge matter, maka di Coulomb phase, both the symmetry and the magnetic one-form symmetry are broken. As before, but something novel happened in the Higgs phase where the gauge symmetry breaks. UN to ZN now, W, expectation value of Wilson line-nya itu tidak nol, reflecting the fact that ZN electric one form symmetry is potentially broken. Ya, yeah. Electric one form symmetry-nya is potentially broken, while the magnetic one form symmetry survives. Alternatively, we could also add just one monopole which condense so that the Gibbs theory confines. Now, Wilson line, expectation value dari Wilson line-nya nol, tetapi expectation value dari Wilson n pangkat n-nya itu tidak nol sih. Dan Walker meter can screen causing this string to break. We see that the Zn electric one form symmetry is unbroken in this phase. Kita bisa lihat kalau kita menambahkan electrically charged meter dengan charge n, maka Zn electric form simetrinya itu unbroken di Higgs phase. The various dynamics on display above suggest the following relationship. Ini punchline-nya. Spontaneously broken form symmetry H, jika one form symmetry H-nya itu spontaneously broken, maka gauge symmetry dari H-nya itu unbroken juga. This is interesting. A discrete gauge symmetry in the infrared is a form of topological order. This is because when compactified on non-trivial manifold, we can have flat connection for this discrete gauge symmetry, which is another way of saying holonomy around cycles. This flat connection can have rise to multiple ground states. Ini menarik karena ini sama saja mengatakan bahwa a discrete gauge symmetry di infrared itu adalah sebuah bentuk dari topological order, karena ketika dikompaktified ke non-trivial manifold, maka flat connection dari di non-trivial manifold ini atau dari discrete gauge symmetry ini yang itu merupakan sama saja dengan holonomy around cycles. Oh, kita bisa mendapatkan flat connection dari discrete symmetry ini atau sama saja, which is another way of saying holonomy around cycles, dan holonomy itu topologi ya. General symmetry yang Mills teori tadi kita bahas di Maxwell, sekarang yang Mills. Finally, we turn to our main topic of interest. We will study general symmetry in Young-Mills theory with two different gauge group, G equal SUN and G equal SUN on Zn. The latter group is sometimes referred to PSUN, defined SUN on Zn. Much of what we have to say will be recapitulation of ideas we saw in section 2.6.2 regarding Adolf and Wilson line. Now, favorite on language of generalized symmetry. Ya, ini sama saja. Kita sudah membahas dulu di 2.6.2, tetapi kita akan memahaminya dengan bahasa generalized symmetry. J equal SUN. Abelian story above has a close analog in non-abelian gauge dynamics. We start by considering the case of simply connected gauge group J equal SUN. We can have Wilson lines in all representation of G with charge lying anywhere with the electric weak lattice. If we did not do Wilson line in the fundamental representation by W, this means that we have WL for all L 1 to infinite. In contrast, the Adolf lines must carry charges in the magnetic root lattice. Ya, kita ingat ya. Kalau yang Adolf line harus charge-nya itu di root lattice. If we denote the fundamental Adolf lines as D, this means that we only have D and N multiple thereof. As long as there is no matter transform under Zn center of SUN, then the theory also has an electric Zn one form symmetry. This acts by shifting the gauge field by flat Zn gauge connection or equivalently inducing a holonomy in the Zn center of SUN. Another way of saying this is that The Wilson line W picks up a phase W, Wn under this one from symmetry. When the theory lies in the confining phase, the Zn word from symmetry is unbroken. Here we have W, expectation value of W itu proportional to E to the minus A. With A is the area of the loop, and the theory has electric flux dips, which due to the absence of fundamental matter cannot break. These electric flux dips are Zn string, which carry charge under Zn one form symmetry. Nah, flux dip yang kita bahas dulu itu bisa kita pahami sebagai atau sesuatu yang carry charge under Zn one form symmetry. This theory also has different phase. We can access this if we introduce scalar field phi transforming the adjoint of the gauge group, so that Zn one form symmetry remains. Then by going to a Higgs phase with phi not equal zero, we have expectation value dari W-nya itu proportional to e to the minus l with l in the parameter of the loop. Now the Zn symmetry is broken karena ininya tidak sama dengan hal ini. Correspondingly, there are no electric flux tips in this phase. However, we now have topological field theory at low energy because G equal SUN transform to Zn. So discrete Zn gauge group symmetry remains. Jadi di Higgs phase ini kita akan dapat topological field theory. Di low energy. Summarizing, we can view the Wilson line as an order parameter for the electric one form symmetry. Ini summary-nya, jadi electric Zn one form symmetry-nya itu unbroken jika expectation value dari W-nya itu proportional to e to the power of minus e, broken jika expression value dari W-nya itu proportional to e to the minus l. Broken Zn one form symmetry give rise to Zn gauge symmetry. Dan nanti kalau dia broken maka dan akan jadi topological field theory. G equal SUN on Zn. Now let's consider how this story changes when G equal SUN on Zn. The Wilson lines are now restricted to lie in the electric root lattice, so only multiple of Wn survive. In contrast, the whole rank of Ethoff lines, TL, with L from 1 to infinite are allowed. Strictly speaking, this is true at theta equals 0. We'll look at role at of the theta angle below. The theory now has a magnetic Zn one form symmetry, whose order parameter is the Ethoff line Tn. We have, nanti kita akan dapati bahwa magnetic Zn one form symmetry-nya itu unbroken. Ya, sama kayak di atas lah. Jika expectation value dari T-nya itu OP arealau, dan dia akan broken jika expectation value dari Ethoff line-nya itu OP parameter lau. So this magnetic Zn one form symmetry broken in the confining phase. Dan ini di Higgs phase ya. Kalau yang ini di Higgs phase. Kalau yang ini di confining phase. Resulting in an emergent Zn magnetic gauge symmetry. Now we turn in discrete gauge symmetries. We are going to need one final piece of technology for our story. This is the idea of a gauge symmetry based on discrete rather than continuous group. It's tempting to think of a gauge symmetry as something in which the transformation can take different values at different points in space. But this approach clearly runs the problem for a discrete group since the transformation parameter cannot vary continuously. Ya, jadi kalau biasanya kita memahami gauge symmetry itu adalah suatu yang bertransformasi dan mempunyai nilai yang berbeda di titik yang berbeda di ruang waktu. Tetapi definisi atau pemahaman ini itu akan mempunyai masalah untuk discrete groups karena parameter transformasinya itu nggak bisa bervariasi secara kontinu. Instead, we should remember by now familiar mantra, gauge symmetries are redundancies. A discrete gauge symmetry simply means that we identify configuration related by this method. Jadi, this gauge symmetry simply mean we identify the configuration related by this symmetry. Ya, seperti biasa, apa namanya? Gauge symmetry kan sama saja kita mengatakan bahwa kalau koneksi yang dia bisa ditransformasi menjadi yang ada yang berhubungan secara gauge, maka dia memberikan fisika yang sama. Makanya dia tadi bilang redundancies. Nah, di sini juga sama, discrete gauge symmetry itu ya ya juga gitu, cuman simetrinya discrete. There is a simple down-to-earth method to arrive at a discrete gauge theory. We start with continuous gauge theory and subsequently break it down to Zn, ya, kayak tadi yang sudah dijelaskan. Indeed, we already saw the two examples of this above. In this first, we start U1 gauge theory. With a scalar of charge n, upon condensation, we have U1 to Zn. Alternatively, we could take SUN gauge theory with adjoint Higgs field giving rise to SUN breaks to Zn. Here we take U1 gauge theory as our starting point. We can focus on the phase phi in 0 to pi of the scalar field. We have a gauge symmetry phi to phi plus n alpha, where alpha proportional to alpha plus 2 pi is also periodic. In the Higgs phase, the scalar kinetic term is ini t square d phi minus n a, which product could start d phi minus n a. Ini di Higgs phase ya. Kinetic term di Higgs phase. For something in air, which is set by the expectation below the scalar. In the low energy limit, t square to infinite, and we have A equal 1 on n d phi, which tells us the connection must be flat. However, something remains because the holonomy or non-contractible loop can be dan dia itu adalah seper n z. It is useful to dualize phi. We do this by first introducing a tree form h and writing l-nya itu sama dengan ini. Integrating out h through the equation of motion. Jadi kita masukkan ini ke sini. Text aspects to the original Lagrangian L1. Nanti bisa dicek sendiri ya. Berarti nanti Hotstar, kalau Hotstar hanya itu 4 pi t square d phi minus na, maka hanya hanya kayaknya sama aja. Iya. Kalau kita masukkan di sini nanti jadi 4 pi t square square per 4 pi 4 pi square coret-coret i t minus. Dan mungkin nanti ganti minus aja. Minus T4 per T ditambah dikurangi. Dua. Oh ya, berarti nanti hanya itu sama dengan 4 pi t square Hotstar d phi minus na. Sehingga ini nanti plus. Kalau itu plus yang ini jadi plus juga. I kali I minus kemudian which productnya kita tukar jadi plus to t square L1 ya sama kayak yang di atasnya. Ini pasti ada yang plus dan minus ya, biar nanti jadinya L1 ini. Kalau di Hotstar kan sepertinya nanti jadi minus di sini. Ya, kalau kayak gini. Maka yang ini akan jadi minus, yang satunya akan jadi plus enggak? I time I minus minus plus kemudian kita geser jadi minus. No, something weird. Mungkin typo di sini, hostarnya harusnya di yang bagian sini atau sesuatu. Ya, yeah, but mungkin lanjutkan dulu. Meanwhile, if we send t square to infinite at this stage, we get the Lagrangian. Kalau infinite, maka yang bagian ini hilang, sehingga hanya sisa ini aja ya. Where H now play the role of Lagrangian multiplier, imposing A equal 1 on N phi. Alternatively, we can instead integrating out phi in L1.5, the equation of motion requires that the H equals 0. This means that we can write H equal dP locally. We are left in the Lagrangian L2 sama dengan ini. In the limit T square to infinity, this become LBF yang BF theory. This Lagrangian is known as BF theory. It is deceptively simple. And as we have seen above, is ultimately equivalent to Zn discrete group symmetries. Our task now is to elucidate how this works. The subtlety arises from the fact that two gauge fields have quantized periods, so when integrating over appropriate cycles, yield ini dan ini. Ini charge-nya berarti ya. The BF theory has two gauge symmetry, A and B. However, as we have seen, the U1 gauge theory for A is actually Higgs down to Zn, a fact which is clear in our initial formulation in L1, but less obvious in BF theory formulation. Similarly, the one form gauge symmetry for B is also Higgs down to Zn, one form gauge symmetry. Ini yang B-nya ya. To see this, we dualize A. We first add a Maxwell term for F and consider the Lagrangian. Ini Maxwell term biasa. If we integrate out one form A hat, we recover the fact that F equal dA locally. Note that if we send E square to infinite, we remove the Maxwell term, ini hilang. We are left with ini. Where F now play the role of Lagrangian multiplier to form. Alternatively, we can instead integrating out F using the equation of motion. Ini to get persamaan ini, jadi tinggal dimasukkan di sini. Nanti coba saya cek lagi. Yang kemarin itu saya udah ketemu, nanti di akhir coba saya singgung lagi. This now takes similar from action L1 that we started with. We should view the dual gauge A hat as a matter field which is charged under B. Correspondingly, the U1 form gauge symmetry is Higgs down to Zn. That we learn from this is that Zn discrete gauge theory also comes with a Zn one form gauge symmetry. Ya, intinya ini. Jadi Zn discrete gauge theory also comes with Zn one form gauge symmetry. The operator, our theory has two gauge symmetry under with phi to phi n plus n alpha and a to n plus d alpha and a hat to a hat plus n lambda and b to b plus d lambda. As we seen As we have seen, both are hexagons to set n. Nonetheless, all operator that we write down must be invariant and symmetric. Okay, example of such operator include dy minus na proportional to star h and da hat minus np proportional to star p. But the equation of motion showed that these are actually related to the dual fields a and h respectively. However, these are trivial in the theory. To find something more interesting, we must turn to line and surface problem. There are two electric operator, Wilson line and Wilson surface. Wilson line. Ini Wilson surface. Bisa dilihat di argumennya ya. C biasanya curve, S surface. Definisinya ini untuk Wilson line dan ini untuk Wilson surface. Bisa dilihat di sini. As usual, the Wilson line describes insertion of probe particle of charge 1 with word line C. Meanwhile, the Wilson surface describes the insertion of vortex string with word sheet S. The scalar phi has winding integral d phi equal to pi around the vortex, which using A equal 1 on n d phi, means that the vortex string carries a magnetic flux 1 n. A particle of charge 1 pick up an holonomy 2 pi on n through the Aronoff bound effect. This is captured in the correlation function. Ini sama dengan ns, di mana ncs the linking number of c in s. This correlation function is non-trivial content of set and gauge theory. We see in particular that the operator WNA and WNP are both trivial in the sense that they commute with all each operator. This can be also understood by set and gauge transformation with respect to general operator ini and shift key to key plus n. Note that we can also think of this as Zn global one form symmetry because WAC proportional to e to the minus L, this one form symmetry is potentially broken in agreement with our previous discussion that this should accompany a Zn gauge symmetry. One might think that there are also ad hoc operator in the theory caused by exponentiating the gauge invariant operator 3.85. The magnetic gauge field dual to A is A star, A hat. And we can write TACS equal exponential I A hat minus I M P. Mirip kayak yang tadi. Jadi kita definisikan ad hoc line dan ad hoc surface. Where now S is surface which end on the line C. The insertion of ad hoc line is equivalent to cutting out a tube S square cross R around C and imposing integral S square F equal to pi. However, the operator TACS is trivial in the theory. First, note that the attached surface operator has charge N and so is invisible. Moreover, by gauge transformation, we can set always set A hat equal 0 locally. The real meaning of ad hoc operator TACS is simply that n Wilson surface operator can end on line. We can view this in a slightly different way. Suppose that there are magnetic monopole of charge 1 under U1 gauge symmetry. The symmetry is Higgs-set, which means that these monopoles are attached to strings. But the minimum string has charge 1 on n, so the monopole is attached to n strings. An analysis operator can be constructed using magnetic dual to P. We have TPPC equal exponential I phi P minus I n integral C A, where C is a line, which n at the point P, the same argument as both, mean that this operator is also trivial, telling us only that and Wilson line operator can end at the point. Ini membahas tentang operator-operator Wilson Landin. Ad hoc line dan hubungannya dengan higher symmetry tadi. Gauging a Zn one-form symmetry. Finally, we can start to put the pieces together. Recall that G equals Un Young Mills has a Zn global electric one-form symmetry that acts on Wilson lines. We'll show that if we promote this one-form symmetry to a gauge symmetry, then we end up with G equals Sun on Zn Young Mills. Jika kita mempromosikan one-form simetrinya itu menjadi gauge symmetry, maka kita akan mendapatkan G equals Sun on Zn Young Mills. We can also play this game in reverse. Starting with G equals Sun on Zn Young Mills, we can get the global magnetic one-form symmetry to return to G equals Sun Young Mills. To this end, let's start with Sun Young Mills. We have a proliferation of gauge field of various kinds, and we are running out of letters. So for this section only, we'll refer to Sun gauge section as A. We will couple this to a BF theory, which we write in the form 3.84. Kita punya ini ya. The trick is to combine Sun gauge connection A with U1 gauge connection V to form a UN isomorphic to U1 cross Sun on Zn connection A sama dengan ini. Here what's going on? We could try to construct a flat connection A from a Sun on Zn bundle, which is not a Sun bundle. This is not allowed in the Sun theories. However, we can compensate this with a gauge connection V, which would not be allowed in a pure U1 theory. The construction cancels between the two, so we are left with a good U1 gauge connection. We then define the U1 field string seperti biasa. This field string is not invariant under one form gauge symmetry of the BF theory, namely, dia nggak invariant terhadap ini dan ini. It transform as G transform to G plus D lambda. This means that we can simply write down the usual Young-Mills term for G. Jadi karena dia nggak gauge invariant, maka kita nggak boleh menulis Young-Mills term yang biasa, yaitu G wedge G star. Instead, we need to form the gauge invariant combination G minus B and write the action. Nah, sekarang kombinasinya itu G minus B wedge G minus B star. Ya, karena B-nya itu bertransform seperti ini ya, sehingga ininya cancel. Note that we have set the theta term to zero because it comes with its own theory, which we will tell later. To see what's happening, we can look at the line operators. We started with Sun gauge theory with Wilson line. Ini. However, this is not variant under the Sun gauge transformation that lie in Sun on Zn rather than Sun. Ini tidak invariant under Un gauge transformation yang Sun on Zn rather than Sun. Jadi dia tidak invariant terhadap Un gauge transformation yang berada di Sun on Zn. So we need to augment it to get a gauge invariant operator. The obvious thing is to do the is to replace A with U1 connection A. Jadi ini mau kita ganti. But now this failed to be gauge invariant under one form symmetry ya, karena koneksi A-nya tadi tidak invariant terhadap one form symmetry, karena one form symmetry kita itu SUN. Harusnya. To resolve this, we need to work with this operator instead, yang dia diberikan seperti itu, di mana boundary dari sigma itu adalah C. This is now kitchen variant, but it comes with its own rules because it's not a line operator but a surface operator. Depending on the choice of sigma, to get an honest line operator, we need to take WNC sigma WNC eksponensial itu. Jadi kita kalikan dengan N. As before, the constraint from integrating outset tell us that N integral sigma P equal integral sigma D. But on any closed manifold, ini sama dengan D pi Z. Kalau dia closed. This means that the line operator WNC sigma doesn't really depend on the choice of sigma. But this is exactly the class of Wilson line which are allowed in SUN on ZN. Jadi awalnya kita tadi SUN, tapi sekarang Wilson lines kita merupakan suatu kelas di SUN on ZN. From our discussion in the previous section, we know that SUN on ZN theory has more out of line than SUN theory that we start from. There are easy to write down in our new formulation. They are itu dengan Z-nya itu, oh ini ya. Data term. Now let's add a data term into the game. One of the key distinction between SUN and SUN on ZN young males is that theta in 0 to 2 pi in the former, while theta equal to pi n in the latter. How does this distinction arise when transforming from one theory to another? Besides writing obvious sketch invariant theta term, ya ini theta term seperti biasa, tapi kalau di kita tadi gauge termnya seperti ini ya. Harusnya ada hot star-nya. Harusnya. Where theta in 0 to 2 pi under the shift ini we apparently have. Ya, nanti bisa. Oh, delta S theta-nya ya. Jadi perubahannya. Ini. The equation of motion for Z tell us that trace G equal dV hat equal NP. Using this relation we have, tinggal dimasukkan ini, kalau kita masukkan hasilnya 0 harusnya, sisanya berarti ini. Kayaknya typo antara entah yang di sini yang minus atau di sini yang plus. Barunya nggak change sign sih. Sepertinya harusnya plus, jadi ini plus. The first term both an integer multiple of 2 pi. Kita tahu ini integer ya. So we have seperti ini. Ya, ininya sama dengan 2 pi i. Salah, 2 pi z. Jalan 4 pi square mah. X pi square malah. We see that the action is invariant under the shift theta to 2 pi. But as we have seen, ya karena ada muncul delta S-nya nggak nol. But as we have seen in another context, what we really care about is E S theta, and this two is not quite invariant. But shift by a contact term for P. Ya ini sih invariant, tapi nanti ada suku ininya yang nggak bisa nol, karena kita ambil eksponensialnya. For this reason, we augment our theta term angle to become, oh, jadi theta termnya ada suku tambahan ini, biar dia invariant terhadap perubahan ini. We'll ultimately see that P plays the role of discrete theta angle. First, we note that, again, the effect of sending theta to theta plus 2 pi is, oh ya, karena nanti akan ada suku ininya, suku ininya nanti ke cancel dengan, bukan cancel sih, akan mengubah ini jadi P minus 1. Ini harusnya plus tadi. Ya, oke. Okay. Kalau ini plus nanti bisa dilihat ya. Nanti delta S tetanya nanti akan membuat ininya jadi plus 1. Eh, minus 1, sorry. In the first case, the P which P term does not look good. Look good invariant under shift P to P plus D lambda. But this is misleading. The term is Gitch invariant provided that P in Z. Jadi kalau P-nya in Z, maka dia akan invariant terhadap ini. Indeed, our original theta term is manifestly Gitch invariant, so this contact term must also be. To see this explicitly, note that under Gitch transformation, we have IPn over 4 pi integral P which P equal, ya, kalau kita transformasikan P to P plus D lambda, jadinya itu ada suku ini plus suku ini. Here the one form has integral d lambda equal to pi z, which means that the last term is the integer multiple of 2 pi. Actually, for n even, this is even true. For n odd, it is true only on spin manifold. Meanwhile, using the constraint np equal to v hat, we also have integral b into pi on nz. So the second term is also integer multiple of 2 pi. Ini juga 2 pi z. Sehingga biar dia invarian terhadap gauge-nya, yaitu kalau eksponens 2 pi jadi kayak gini ya, sama dengan 1, maka p-nya ini harus integer. And the partition function is gauge invariant. Finally, notice not that this same integrality constraint means that 1 on pi, 4 pi integral p which p into pi n square z. This means that the discrete theta angle p can take the values 0 sampai n minus 1. Ini ada constraint lagi. As you would expect, the theta angle of SUN theory will be 2 pi p plus theta, di mana semua itu harusnya apa namanya, anggota 0 to 2 pi n, semua ini ya. In agreement with our earlier discussion in section 2.6.2, we'd next like to see how the discrete theta angle P shifts the electric charge of ad hoc lines. First, it's a fairly straightforward, albeit slightly hand-waving argument if you write. P-nya equal dV hat. Tadi kayaknya ada. ini ya, kita punya constraint ini. P-nya dv hat per n. That we see this look like a standard theta term theta equal to pi p on n for v hat. This will give electric charge to the lines of v hat, which are equivalent to Wilson line in the case with v. These are precisely the operator 3.89, which we identified and now emerging at half lines of SUN in ZN. Oh, dia itu ini ya. There is a more direct way to see this. We can also directly require that Z transform under one form gauge symmetry as the integrality condition, and ini is retained if P in Z is rendered the theory gauge invariant without imposing the constraint dV hat equal MP. Jadi walaupun nggak ada constraint dV hat in MP, integrality conditionnya itu tetap membuat teorinya itu gauge invariant with the gauge transformation on Z. We see immediately that the atom lines are no longer gauge invariant. Transforming DC itu ada suku tambahan ini. To compensate, we force to use the line operator. Nah, sekarang line operator kita kita beri suku tambahan itu ya. This is the dynamic line operator in which magnetic at half lines pick up an electric charge. This is precisely the expected effect of discrete entangle. Terakhir, at half anomaly in time reversal. It's been rather a long road to put together all the machinery that we need, but finally we can put these ideas together to tell something new. We sketch the main idea at the beginning of this section. We start with G equals UN, Young Mills, which, as we now know, enjoy a ZN global electric one-form symmetry at two special values, theta equal theta, theta equal zero, and theta equal pi. It also enjoys time reversal invariance, as we review in section 1.2.5. Suppose that we work in the theory with theta equal 0. If we catch the Zn one form symmetry, then we find ourselves flat with G equal SUN on Zn Young-Mills theory. Now with theta at theta SUN on Zn equal to 2 pi p, with p is discrete theta angle that operate in 3.91. Jadi kalau kita catch Zn one form symmetry di SUN, maka kita akan jadi SUN on Zn, dan theta angle-nya itu akan jadi ini. Karena tadi jadi tuh berubah jadi ini ya, kalau thetanya sama dengan 0 ya jadi tuh pi. We are always free to pick p equal 0 and we end theory which preserves the time reversal invariant. Dan kita udah lihat bahwa kalau theta equal 0 maka dia preserve time reversal invariant ya kemarin. However, life is different if we sit in theta equal pi. Now if we catch the Zn one form symmetry, we are left with G equal SUZn and yang but tetapi dia akan jadi ini dari persamaan tadi yang kita turunkan. For some p equal z, this theory is time reversal invariant only when theta SUN on Zn equal 0 and theta SUN Zn equal pi n. Apakah bisa? Karena P-nya itu 0, 1 sampai N, 1. Kalau pi N pun nggak bisa. Let's now consider an event. In this case, there is no choice of P in NO. Wait. There is no choice for P. For which our final theory is time reversal invariant. We learned that if we start with theta equal pi, then we can go to the Zn1 symmetry at the cost of losing time and reversal invariant. Makanya tadi nggak akan bisa retain karena P-nya nggak ada yang sesuai. In other words, we have mixed at of anomaly between Zn1 symmetry and time reversal. Ya. Ini punchline-nya di sini sih. So, the consequence, importantly, this anomaly must be reproduced in low energy physics. At theta equals zero, we expect Young-Mills theory to be in a gap boring phase with nothing interesting going on beyond the strong coupling scale lambda GCD. But this cannot be the case at theta equal pi. Whatever phases occur, there has to account for the anomaly. There are three options. The first option are entirely analogous to the our discussion of ad hoc chiral anomaly in section 3.5. But the third is novel. Time reversal invariant is potentially broken at theta equal pi. This means that theory is kept by with two degenerate ground states. Ini kita udah bahas yang kemarin ya. There can be domain walls between these two states. Note that there is a theorem due to Fava and Witten which says that the parity cannot be spontaneously broken in vector like gauge theories, but this theory explicitly applies only at theta equal zero. Jadi di theta equal zero itu parity cannot be spontaneously broken in vector like gauge theories. Tapi hanya di theta equal zero ya. The theory is gapless at theta equal pi, and the resulting theory reproduces the discrete at the anomaly. The theory is the last choice atau the last option itu dia the theory is topological. This means that it is kept with no low energy propagating degree of freedom, but still has interesting thing going on. One way to prove the subtle behavior of the theory is to place it on a non-trivial background manifold. Harus kompak ya. For example, the number of ground state depend on the topology of the manifold. Output when n is odd, here it look as if we are in better shape because we can always pick p equal n minus 1 on 2. Kenapa bisa ya? Tadi karena di sini bilangnya p-nya can take value di sini aja. To end up with theta su n z n equal n pi. This means that strictly speaking, there is no ad hoc anomaly in this case. However, there is a global inconsistency because there is no choice of p which preserves time reversal for both theta equal zero and theta equal pi. Jadi kalau kita ambil p-nya sama dengan ini, maka kita pasti akan lose salah satu entah yang theta equal zero atau theta equal pi. If we assume that the theory is confining, kept and boring when theta equals zero, then there's always the possibility that the theory undergoes a first order phase transition if we vary theta from zero to pi. However, if there is no such phase transition, then the theory at theta equal pi must be again non-trivial. The sense that it falls into one of the three categories lies listed above. Thus, in the absence of a first order phase transition, there is no difference between n, even, and odd. So, which of this possibility occur, we don't know for sure, but we can take some hints from large N. In section 3.2.5, we'll show that when N very great greater than one, the first option above occurs and the time reversal is potential problem at theta equal pi. There is a general expectation that this behavior persists for most, if not all, n, simply on the ground that it appears to be simplest option. There is over one tantalizing possibility for G equals U and Young-Mills. It has been suggested that the theory at theta equal pi is actually gapless. Untuk ini, ya kira-kira apa namanya, ada proposal bahwa sepertinya teori yang Mills SU2 itu gapless di theta equal pi, and its dynamic described by a single U1 gauge field. We currently have no way to determine whether this phase is realized or if time reversal is again spontaneously broken. Sebelum ke counter reading, saya mau ulang sedikit yang kemarin. Jadi ketika tetanya jadi 2 pi, maka di sini akan ada suku tambahan x dot plus a not ya. Dan kalau kita a notnya kita jumlahkan ke sini, dia nanti akan jadi p plus 1 a not, dan x dotnya akan ada di sini juga. Kalau kita pakai partial l plus partial x dot, nanti hasilnya adalah m x dot plus theta per 2 pi plus 1. Jadi bisa dibilang dia nanti p plus 1 di sini, dan di suku yang ini dia juga p plus 1 juga. Yang saya paham. Jadi, jadi dengan cara yang sama, kalau a-nya kita ganti a0 dan x-nya kita ganti x0, maka ini akan jadi ini dengan cara yang seperti kemarin. Kita tetanya apa namanya, x dotnya kan berubah jadi minus, a0-nya juga berubah jadi minus. Jadi suku yang ini nanti akan jadi sub minus theta per 2 pi x dot plus a0. Kalau mau kita ubah biar ini jadi plus, kita harus jumlahkan dengan, kalau tetanya pi ya, kalau tetanya pi ini setengah, kita harus jumlahkan dengan x dot plus a0, tapi kita kurangi dengan x dot plus a0. Ini plus ini nanti jadi setengah x dot plus a not, berarti nanti berarti ini sama aja mengatakan minus pi nya tadi ini berubah menjadi plus pi. Kemudian ini bisa masuk ke sini, a not nya ini bisa masuk ke sini, sehingga suku yang terakhir tadi jadi p. P plus 1 a not, atau minus p minus 1 ya. Ya, seperti itu. Kita baca sedikit code reading-nya, tidak banyak. The anomaly is one of the more subtle aspects of quantum field theory, like much of the subject thinks roots in the combination of experimental particle physics and healthy dose of other confusion. The story starts with an attempt to understand the decay of the neutral pion pi naught into two photon. Oh, makanya ada triangle diagramnya. The story will be told more detail in section 5.4.3. The neutral point is uncharged, so does not couple directly to photon. In 1945, Sternberger suggested that the decay occurs through a loop process with the SUN isospin triplet of pions coupling to the proton and neutron doublet and through the interaction. The setting up amplitudes get pretty close to measured pion decay rate of 10 to the power of minus 16. It appears that all was good. The trouble comes some decades later with the relation that the pion is a cold stone boson. We'll explain this when we discuss chiral symmetry breaking in section 5. This means that the coupling of the form 3.93 are not allowed. The pion can have only derivative coupling. Karena dia cold stone boson. Indeed, one can show that if all symmetries of the classical Lagrangian hold, then a generally massless pion will be unable to decay into two photons. The previous success in predicting the decay of pion suddenly appeared coincidental. The anomaly provides the resolution to this puzzle, as first pointed by Bell and Jacque in 1969. Yes, that Bell. Ya, yeah, maksudnya Bell yang ada di Bell Theorem. Ya. Bell Theorem di quantum mechanic. And independently by Adler, the extension to non-abelian gauge group was made by Bardeen in the same year. At this point in time, his death had only one Nobel Prize. Ini Bardeen ini kayaknya yang kakak beradik yang kakak beradik namanya anak bapak yang dapat Nobel Prize. The gravitational contribution sepertinya nanti dicoba lagi. The gravitational contribution chiral anomalies computed early in lama ya ternyata maksudnya 1972 by Delbourgo and Salam. The fact that the anomalies cancel the standard model was first shown in that citation. Albert phrased as avoiding lack of renormalizability rather than avoiding of fatal inconsistency. Ya, belum tahu kalau yang mungkin belum sadar kalau matematika inconsistency-nya itu. Mereka memahaminya sebagai lack of renormalizability, bukan lack of mathematical inconsistency. In fairness, no renormalizability was thought to be fatal at the time. Oh ya. Yeah. The first hint that the anomaly was related to something deeper can be first some improved by Adler and Bardeen that this one look exact. But the full picture took some years to emerge. The relation between instanton and the anomaly was first realized by Adhoff, and the connection to the single index theory was made in that citation. The path integral approach that we described in the lecture is due to Fujikawa and was developed 10 years after the anomaly was first discovered. Berarti 1982 ya. This was perhaps the first time that property of an integral measure was shown to play an important role in quantum theory. This has been major theme since not least with Witten's discovery in 1982 of the SU2 anomaly. Anomaly yang non non perturbatif anomali ya. Excellent review of anomaly can be found lecture by Bilal and RV. The idea of Adhoff anomaly as important concern in low energy physics was introduced by Adhoff in the lectures. That citation. Its application to chiral symmetry breaking will be described in section 5.6. Section 3.6 on anomaly in discrete symmetry contains somewhat newer material. Discrete gauge symmetry have a long history on lattice and in continuum. Were discussed in the number of papers studying geometry through the lens of GFT. The presentation of BF given here was largely taken from and generalized higher form symmetries from 70. The fact that these higher form symmetries can have mixed anomaly with discrete symmetries such as time reversal was described in 71. The theorem which says that time reversal or parity cannot be spontaneously broken at theta equals zero can be found in that citation. The quantum mechanics analog of particle on part circle is taken from appendix 71. Ya, jadi di bab ini kita belajar tentang gauge anomali ya. Dan awalnya itu fisikawan mau memahami decay dari natural pion. Jadi dia ada triangle diagram yang sering kita bahas di gauge, di anomali tadi. Tetapi karena apa, perlu memahami atau baru sadar bahwa pion itu Goldstone boson, harusnya coupling yang seperti ini itu enggak ada. Dan anomali baru comes into play in the game. Dan seterusnya, dan seterusnya. Ya, apa yang kita bahas ini lumayan. Modern dalam artian ya kalau GFT dan lain-lain kan 1910-an sampai sebelum WW2. Setelah WW2 GFT dan ya mungkin berhenti sampai standar model sih. Belum selanjutnya banyak masih meraba-raba, belum ada teori yang konsisten dengan eksperimen-eksperimen atau ya belum ada eksperimen yang bisa menjudge teorinya benar atau salah. Ya, that's for chapter 3. Next, we'll discuss about lattice gauge theory.